of psychedelics and its implications for mood disorders. So thank you, Franz.
So thank you very much for the kind introduction. Thank you for coming so late in the evening. I had been asked whether I could give a summary of the research, but I think it's too much to summarize in 17 minutes, 25 years of research into psychedelics. So I want to give you a few examples, and I want to show you how we approach the understanding of the mechanism of psychedelics in humans. We do mostly human research, but we also go to animals to study molecular aspects of the mechanism. So I first talk a little bit about the phenomenology, but we have already heard from all speakers so far how we measure these states. I will show you some improvements. Then I will go into some neural correlates of altered states. If we can describe what the subject experience in more detail, we can study what's going on in the brain, but we need better measures. Then I go a little bit into emotion regulation, two examples, and then we're looking for new compounds and to explain these effects. So, psychedelics have been discovered in Switzerland, everybody knows that, by Hoffman. And since then, at our institute, we do a lot of research. It was mostly, in the beginning, research into psychedelics as a model of psychosis, and nowadays into the molecular pharmacology of psychotic states. But the other thing was use them in psycholytic and psychedelic therapy. And my group, we started in 1990, doing all the neuroimaging and EEG and all that technology, are much more interested how do they affect normal volunteers. And more recently, Rainer Kreinmann in our group has started to study psychedelics, particularly psilocybin, in depressed patients. You have all heard that psychedelics have a certain structure in space, and this structure is similar between different groups of psychedelics, your LSD, your hydroxy, LSD, your psilocybin. If you look at these rings and this side chain, it's all very similar. And this was the idea or the rationale to look for receptors in the brain in the 80s. It's not so long ago. And this is a similar compound, bufotenin from toads in animals. So the structure is also similar. Then we use also mescaline. I don't go into that now, with not a psychedelic, a classical one. It's phenylethylamine and not a classical indolamine like its indole compounds here. We study these chemical things so in detail because we want to modify these molecules. We cut off these side chains here and there to have psychedelics that are short acting or longer acting, less side effect and so on, maybe better in certain types of depression. So let's go to the next. Phenomenology. So you heard about Dietrich at our institute had developed the rating scales in the 70s and 80s, measuring this oceanic boundlessness. On the other side, kind of opposite pole, the anxious ego dissolution, acoustic alteration we have in, and visual restructuralization, that means all the visionary experiences. The scale was designed to measure the common denominator of altered state. It was not designed to measure states just induced by drugs like psilocybin. This was originally the user that has been used to construct the scale. DMT, LSD, ketamine, mescaline, N2O, as laughing gas, psilocybin, cannabis, but also relaxation techniques and meditation went on to construction or sensory deprivation and sensory overload. It was a long development to get the rating scale better and better over years. But now we have done another approach. We have done over the last 20 years a number of studies, a total about 80 studies with psychedelics, and we came up to modify all these dimensions, oceanic boundlessness, we measure now as noetic consciousness, deeply felt positive mood, feelings of unity, disembodiment, changing of the meaning of percepts, and the visual stuff goes into visual alterations, simple hallucination, complex hallucinations, synesthesia, and also meaning of perceptions or loads of both scales. So we just modified these scales to have better ideas how we can study the brain and what's the commonality between different drugs. Here, for instance, on the left side, you see different doses for psilocybin. If you enhance the dose, you go from this to this to this. In terms of audiovisual synesthesia or vivid imagery, it's a complex hallucination. We can, with the dose, increase the effect on this axis. Other axes do not increase insightfulness, or, for instance, disembodiment does not go up. And if you compare this, for instance, with ketamine, ketamine has much more power on this disembodiment, losing the feeling of how you feel your body, and so on. Also, the commonalities in our very early data showed that ketamine and psilocybin may affect different and similar brain regions, if you look at the overlap here. So, the interesting thing is that you can have alterations in different brain regions, but they are not linked to the psychological experience at all. So you can have higher or less activity in a certain area, but this has no effect on the psyche. So we always start from the psyche. We want to measure what people experience, and then we go back to the brain. So, just as a principle. Now in the 70s, Leuner already indicated that psychedelics can improve symptoms in depression. And he thought that psychedelics activated an emotional matrix, something like a matrix you have learned over your lifetime. Since the birth, you start to get conditioned and you adapt to emotional interactions and so on. And Charlie Grupp showed as the first, some years ago, in 2011, that psilocybin in fact reduces measures of depression. So we thought, can we measure that? Because when you treat patients, you should have predictors, you should sort out your patients, you should describe them, why and how are they depressed, what are possible alterations in their brain processing. And one thing they have, depressed patients react very differently to fearful and happy faces or neutral faces. You can measure that by EEG, and the response is quite different to negative emotions and anger. They look much longer at negative pictures when they have negative thoughts. They ruminate, they think about the negative thoughts, they cannot get rid of them. So if we have such a readout, we call that, you can also use fMRI or other measurements, imaging, you have a measure where you can say, okay, this kind of depression is linked to an altered brain processing. And we call that emotional bias. Bias in terms of, it's an attentional bias, it's an emotional bias, and it's also a perceptual bias. Depressed patients have in three dimensions, they hang on into the negative thing. When we understand this, we go with this measure to the depressed patient, we characterize them, and then we treat them with psilocybin or ketamine or whatsoever. On the other hand, we go back to the animals and look at new molecules that may even improve. It's all different LSD derivatives we have here. We tested a number of them, and we see what's going on in the mouse. In the mouse, you have an induction of new synapses, so that's induction of long-term neuroplasticity, and if you change the wiring of the brain, you can learn fast. It's one thing we learned out of psilocybin and LSD, that it's a glutamate-driven neuroplastic effects. And this goes back then, when we learn that, understand that to the patient. That's the concept we use. So, what we could demonstrate under many others is, if depressed patients look at negative faces, they have marked activation of the amygdala, a center for anxiety, and a reduction in frontal cortex. So this is a nice measure. Now you can use a patient, give them psilocybin or a healthy volunteer and you can look, is there really some changing in this process? This is just theory, we don't go into that now. Now, just as an example, such a task, there are little videos people see for 20 seconds, happy, neutral, anxious, and we give that 20 millisecond long, or up to 200, and only 10. And if you present these videos very fast, people, the brain detects it, but people are not aware of that, so it's a subconscious stimulation. And we wanted to know, do psychedelics alter the unconscious processing and the conscious processing? What I just show here, for non-conscious people didn't see the picture, but the brain detected fearful, it's this negativity here, these neutral pictures, and these are happy pictures. And if you give a little bit ketamine, this response of the brain is modified, it's smaller here, non-conscious, and if people saw the picture, it's dramatically modified. So consciousness is important to detect the environment and to scan the environment constantly, but with ketamine they react much less to fearful faces, is what we hypothesized. Neutral are not much affected, but happy are also affected. But now the interesting thing is that psilocybin does not reduce the processing of happy faces, for instance, but just fearful. There's just a difference between ketamine and psilocybin, and it's also a reason we did much more research into psilocybin and related compounds to find out why is that bias, that psilocybin reduces the processing of negative emotions but not of happy. So we can skip that. Rainer Kramer went then into the brain and he could demonstrate that people don't react to these negative faces, and the amygdala really does not react in the right side of the brain too much to these negative things. So we have measurements in EEG, we have measurements with fMRI, and this reduction to the negative stimuli correlates with the increase of positive affects, and this is a good measure we can use in patients to follow them. We give them a training in psychotherapy for 4 weeks. We prepare them with a mindfulness training, and then they get a psilocybin session, and then we measure them before and after. And want to understand, is this really so that psilocybin modifies the processing? So we did other measurements with PET, and we saw that in fact frontal regions have an effect on the amygdala. We have known that from many studies, but ketamine and psilocybin both can enhance that and facilitate this. We also found then that it's really depending on the 2A receptor, the serotonin 2A is important. Psychedelics stimulate this receptor. And we found, what Thomas said, we found that they also, people on psilocybin can better read out of the eyes, the emotion of other people, some marked increase here. And this was dependent on the 2A receptor. So we know more about the receptor. We went on to social interaction, the most recent studies. And if people play a game with other people, for instance in scanner, people are playing a kind of ball game. And this gives a pain signal. Oh, I have to go back, sorry. And, these are these different activations in the frontal cortex, and psilocybin reduces that activation, and people feel less excluded if they cannot play, or if they are not included, if they get included in this game. So people are laying in the scanner, play with two other people in the institute through a computer. If they get excluded, normally you have a physical pain, but you have a mental pain, very similar activation. Now psilocybin reduces that feeling of exclusion, and the more these areas are, the less they are activated, the better people can integrate these feelings of exclusion. But more interesting is that we found that this change in activity correlates now with neurochemistry, when we directly measured the same thing a little later, 30 minutes later, the activation of the glutamate system and the aspartate system, two neurotransmitters that are very important, we found, for the activation or inducing the psychedelic state. Psilocybin and LSD activate serotonin receptors, we know that. This get activated, this get deactivated, but they strongly, through this mechanism, activate glutamate system and this receptor. There's a bunch of other receptors that get activated. Now we think glutamate in the frontal cortex is very important for psychedelic effects. In fact, what we did, we blocked these receptors. If you block the 2A receptor, the symptoms go down. If you block 1A receptors, visual aspects go down. You have an emotional trip, but no visual effect if you block the 1A receptors. You can play on that game to other receptors. You can modify the experience. Here we use new psilocybin derivatives that are more going more on the 2A receptors on this side, and this go more on the 1A receptors, so we can modify the experience. So this we skip. This is a lot of technology. Maybe interesting for you. We used recently LSD in a study, and LSD also activates the serotonin system. Also the 2A is very important, the 1A, but also the dopamine system. We think that after 3 or 4 hours of LSD, activation of the dopamine system can sometimes lead to the paranoid experience some people have with higher doses. But the astonishing thing we found is with ketamine, we completely block the LSD effect and also completely block the brain activation. Just one little game how we study these things. So, importantly, glutamate goes up as a new finding, and we think that this glutamate activates mechanism in the brain that leads to neuroplastic effects. So, it's very complex. 2A receptors get activated, and a lot of internal cell activation we have by psychedelics who are psychoactive. And interestingly, if we use other compounds that are not active but also stimulate the receptors like glyceride, they are not psychedelic. And the trick is that only specific internal pathways have to be activated by DOM, by mescaline, by LSD, by psilocybin, as a second messenger cascade, allow us to differentiate whether a compound is psychedelic or not. And this is the newest trick from Gonzalez-Mueza from New York. This 2A receptors here are not alone, as thought. They are together with another family of receptors, glutamate receptors. And now you can come with drugs here and induce a trip and can completely bypass LSD and psilocybin and just modify this activity. And in animal it works. So we can activate this receptor, then it blocks the psychedelic effect. We can deactivate this receptor, then you are on the trip without LSD and psilocybin. It's a new generation of drugs coming through this mechanism. So I hope you learned a little bit how we do it, and thank you very much for your attention. A lot of people also are involved in our research. Thank you very much.